Welcome to our brief lesson on Sanskrit vowels. We'll be going over their pronunciation and their transliteration according to the international standard. It'll take just a few minutes, so let's get started. There are 13 vowels in the Sanskrit language, and they are differentiated not only by their vowel sounds, but also by the duration for which they are sounded. Thus, we have short vowels and long vowels. Hitting the precise vowel sounds makes all the difference in the quality of our Sanskrit pronunciation. Let's see what this means. We start off with the first pair of vowels. These are sounded as follows. A, A. Notice how the first short vowel was just a short wrap of a sound, whereas the longer vowel was more drawn out. Also, in this case, the vowel sounds themselves are distinct. Listen carefully one more time. A, A. Let's move on to the next pair of vowels, and they are sounded as follows. I, I. A vowel letter with a bar over it or a line over it is always going to be long. I'll say that one more time. E, E. The next pair of vowels are sounded U, U. Notice that the long vowel has the bar or the line over it. I'll say them one more time. U, U. The next pair of vowels are pronounced R. This is the vowel sound in the name Krishna, R. The long version of this vowel is pronounced R. This vowel sound is extremely rare, and at this point in the course, don't worry about it too much. I'll say them one more time. R. R. The next vowel is also very rare and is pronounced L. L. The last four vowels are all long. A, I, O, Au. Notice that they're all long, but they don't have a bar or line on top of their letters. Keep that in mind when you're reading out Sanskrit transliteration. I'll say them one more time. A, I, O, Au. And that completes the list of 13 vowels. Let's go through them all at once now. Read along if you like. I'll go through them slowly. A, A. I, I. U, U. R, R. L, A, I, O, Au. Apart from the 13 vowels, there are two ornaments to the vowels. The first is called the Anuswara. Anu means to follow, and Swara or Swara means vowel. So this literally means that which follows a vowel. The Anuswara is a nasal M sound similar to the M at the end of the English word sum. Its exact nasal pronunciation actually differs slightly according to certain grammar rules, but at this point, for our purposes, we can pronounce it like a nasal M. So, for example, we would pronounce balam and samsara. The second ornament is called the visarga, and this is simply an aspirate, where the breath is expelled in a very short burst along with the preceding vowel sound. Some examples to illustrate this are shaktihi, kamaha, ubhayoho. Notice how the visarga always takes on the preceding vowel sound. Now let's go through a few examples to illustrate how to read these vowel sounds and how important they are in correct pronunciation. Let's start with this word. The way it's written right now, the two syllables in this word are bi and j. Both the vowel sounds are short, so this word would be pronounced bija. However, if we made the second vowel sound long by putting a bar over the a, this word would now be pronounced bija. Bija. If we made both the vowel sounds long, this would be said as bija. Bija. And finally, if the first vowel sound was long, this would be pronounced bija. Bija. And the word bija in Sanskrit means seed. So do you notice how much of a difference it makes to hit the right long and short vowel sounds? Let's try one more example. Komala. In this case, all three vowel sounds are long. The O is always a long vowel sound, and the A with a bar over it is a long vowel sound. So this word is pronounced Komala. In this case, we would say Komala. Komala. And finally, this would be pronounced Komala. Komala. The word Komala in Sanskrit means gentle. Let's try another example. Kumuda. Listen carefully to the difference between the short and the long vowel sounds. Kumuda. If both the first two vowel sounds were long, this would be said as kumuda, kumuda. And finally, this would be pronounced kumuda, all three vowel sounds being short, kumuda. Kumuda is a kind of beautiful flower. Let's try one last example. Sadhana. All three vowel sounds in this are short, so our three syllables are sa, dha, na, sadhana. In this case, the three syllables are sa, dha, na. So this word would be pronounced sadhana, sadhana. Sadhana, sadhana. And finally, sadhana, sadhana. The word sadhana in Sanskrit means spiritual practices. Welcome to our short lesson on Sanskrit consonants and other letters. We'll be explaining the pronunciation along with their transliteration symbols. Let's begin with the consonants. The word consonant comes from two Latin root words which literally translate to with sound. A consonant can only be sounded explicitly when it is given a sound by the use of a vowel. If there is no vowel to modify it, the sound of the consonant remains unmanifest. Take, for example, the English word mat. It ends with the consonant T, but that consonant is not explicitly sounded. The mouth and tongue get into position for the T, but because there is no vowel after it, the sound remains unsaid. Contrast this with the word matador, and we see that the consonant now is explicitly sounded along with the vowel. In a manner of speaking, vowels give life to consonants. This is true in Sanskrit as well, and thus in order to be able to practice the pronunciation of the consonants, we will sound them along with the vowel a. Recall from our lesson on vowels that this is the first short vowel in Sanskrit. There are five groups of consonants in the Sanskrit alphabet, and they are grouped according to the structure of the mouth and tongue required to pronounce them. Each group has five letters. Let's take a look at each of these groups one by one. The first group of consonants are gutturals, which means they come from the throat. The air is blocked by the tongue at the back of the throat until a vowel comes along and releases the air along with the sound. The five consonants in this group are k, kh, g, gh, ng. Let's go over them in more detail. The first consonant is pronounced k. Try saying this while releasing as little air as possible. There should be no unnecessary gush of air along with this sound. K. The next consonant is pronounced k. This is an aspirated consonant, and the air pressure behind the tongue is released with a little force along with the sound. K. The third consonant is pronounced g. It is similar to the first consonant, except that in this case the vocal cords are resonated and the sound comes from deeper in the vocal chamber. G. The fourth consonant is pronounced g. This is similar to the second consonant. Air is released with the sound, but this time the vocal cords are resonated. The last consonant is pronounced ng. Just place your tongue in the same position as the rest of the consonants and then make a nasal sound. As we go through the other consonant groups, you will notice that this pattern for the letters in a group remains the same. So here we have the gutturals k, kh, g, gh, ng. The next group are called palatals. The tongue seals the air behind it by lying along the roof of the mouth, and that seal is broken by a vowel. The palatals are pronounced ch, ch, j, j, n. I'll go over them again. Listen carefully, especially to the difference between the aspirated and non-aspirated sounds. Ch, ch, j, j, n. The next group are called cerebrals, where the tongue seals the breath behind it by arching up firmly against the roof of the mouth. The cerebrals have a very hard and sharp sound, and they are all represented by letters with a dot beneath them. This is how they go. T, th, d, dh, n. I'll go over them one more time. T, th, d, dh, n. The next group of consonants are called dentals, and they are fairly easy to pronounce. Here the tongue comes up against the back of the teeth, which are slightly parted. The dentals are pronounced as follows: t, the, dha, na. I'll go over them one more time. Ta, tha, da, dha, na. The fifth and final group of consonants are called labials. The five labials are P, P, B, B, M. I'll say them one more time. P, P, B, B, M. That completes the five consonant groups. What remains are the semi-vowels, sibilants, and aspirates. Let's find out what they're about. The semi-vowels are so called because they are based on the in-between or transition sound when moving from a vowel to the Sanskrit vowel a. For example, the transition from e to a gives us the semi-vowel ya. E to a, e, a, e, a, ya, ya. See how that came about? Similarly, r to a gives us r. L to a gives us l. And finally, u to a gives us v, which is sometimes pronounced by rounding the lips as in Swami. So the semi-vowels are y, r, l, v. Very easy to pronounce. A sibilant is a hissing sound. There are three kinds of hissing sounds in Sanskrit. The first is a palatal sh, sh. This is the sh of Shiva. The second is a cerebral sh. This is the sh of Krishna, Krishna. And the final is the dental s, s. Sh, sh, s. It is common for people to pronounce the first two without distinction, and this approximation goes unnoticed. Usually in Sanskrit words, the tongue automatically gets into position for the correct sh sound. Finally, Sanskrit has one aspirate, which is simply an expulsion of air along with the appropriate vowel sound. H. H. With this, we complete all the consonants, semi-vowels, sibilants, and aspirates in Sanskrit. Now let's go over the whole list on one page to see how they sound. We'll start with the five consonant groups. K, kh, g, gh, ng. Ch, ch, j, jh, n. T, th, d, dh, n. T, th, d, dh, n. P, ph, b, bh, m. Next comes the four semi-vowels. Y, r, l, v. Followed by the three sibilants. Sh, sh, sa, and finally the aspirate ha.